have gathered here a group of people from the trade unions, from management, representing workers, representing the wider community, to talk about a subject which is critical. Globalization, a big word. Globalization, what does it mean to you and me? It's the way the world is ordering itself in doing business, and it has tremendous impact on workers and managers, on the citizens at large. In this production, we're going to be having a discussion, a free-flowing discussion, in which we look at the implication of this subject. What does it mean for a worker? How do you organize the workplace? What about government and governance? How does the average citizen, the man, the woman in the street, the person at the workplace, the person unemployed, what is the implication for a young person who has to look at a job? What do you think about a job in the future when the world is changing so fast? So this discussion is meant to excite your own thoughts, is a way of perhaps raising the question in a way that you have never raised it before. We hope that when you have viewed this, you will have some thoughts of your own and use this film as a means of discussing the subject. Globalization, what does it mean to me? We begin by inviting each participant to tell in his or her own words the definition of globalization.
Joe Matalon, I'm the president of the McCalla Group, and I think the simplest definition of globalization, perhaps, is that it is an international phenomenon of the establishment of a single world marketplace with a free exchange of goods and capital across national boundaries. I think that the process of globalization means that we are creating a single marketplace for the movement of goods and services and capital. The old trade barriers have been broken down or are in the process of being broken down, and we have free trade. Now, there are significant consequences that come of this, and the preparation as globalization takes place, the technological change that has taken place in the world, the transportation changes that have taken place in the world, all of these make the trading process of goods and more so of services that much easier to effect. Services obviously are reflected in the internet and its impact on international trade.
I'm Trevor Munro. I'm president of the University and Allied Workers Union, and I'm a professor at the University of the West Indies. I agree with Joe as to what globalization means. It's a process, it's not an event. It's a process whereby borders become less and less significant, so that one day, in fact, the borders between countries may be as insignificant as the border between Kingston and St. Andrew, or between St. Andrew and St. Catherine. For just the movement of people, the movement of goods, the movement of services, and of course the movement of criminals, the movement of disease, and all the other negatives. And I think that from a very personal level, if one thought of one's family, I don't think there's a Jamaican whose family is not globalized in terms of an uncle, an auntie, a cousin, a son or a daughter living somewhere else. If you think of yourself in the last 2 or 3 weeks, there's probably not a Jamaican who has not been in touch with the outside world in some form or fashion, whether through cable television, whether through the telephone, the fax machine. It's as if it no longer matters where you are, because wherever you are is as if you are anywhere else, and that's where we're going. And I think that has many considerable opportunities, but also threats, and we need to be aware of both in order to ensure that we maximize the opportunities and minimize the threats.
My name is Joan Lawrence. I'm a worker delegate for the National Workers Union. I agree with Mr. Matalon. It's a phenomenon. Globalization is a phenomenon which will push all of us, workers, managers, trade unionists, consumers, everybody in Jamaica, into the 20th century, and then launch us to the 21st century. It'll make us think about being citizens of the real world. We are no longer little Jamaica here sitting, being idyllic, as some people think. We are. We have to compete in the global marketplace, and therefore, this opening up of information and all the technology is going to help to push us into doing business, even just living here in Jamaica. It's going to change the way we do things here in Jamaica.
I'm Douglas Orane. I'm chairman of Grace Kennedy. I agree with what Joe said earlier. I would make some additions. Besides goods and services and capital, there's also the globalization of the labor market. And in fact, that's what most Jamaicans are concerned about, because most of us are workers, including myself as a chief executive officer. What is happening is that these markets are globalizing at different rates, some faster than others, some slower. There's also something very important happening as markets globalize. More and more in the world, those of us who share a common bond, such as our common culture, are being drawn closer and closer together, because there's a parallel trend of political fragmentation in the world, where you find smaller and smaller political units, where people want to be more involved in what is happening around them, at the same time that you have this paradoxical trend towards larger and larger economic blocks. And I believe there's an advantage in it for Jamaica, because there are 5 million of us in the world, 2.5 million here on the rock, and 2.5 million abroad. And if we all pull together, I think we have a tremendous opportunity to do well as a people in the future.
I'm Blossom Amelia Nelson, Project Director of the Workforce Development Consortium. And I think that those who have spoken previously have really captured the broad meaning of globalization. But I like to think of it as cultural penetration, because I think that the almost cataclysmic shifts that it has caused the society has really changed the whole business of our aspirations, our expectations, how we see ourselves, the things that we want. And the demands for competitiveness have really created rapid changes within companies, within the way managers and strategic planners do business, the way in which workers respond, how workers must be prepared. But in addition to that, it is changing the way people market themselves, the way they market products, and the things that they are prepared to do to compete locally and to compete internationally. And the whole business of values, of national identity, of a national perspective, of a personal perspective, and what is good, what is sound, what is valuable, seems to get swept under the carpet in this bid to outrun the person beside you. And I think that the whole impact on our humanness, and our whole impact on our intellectual capital and the human resources is going to be so great that my concern is that we just will not know where we are, what we are doing there, and what to do next if we don't get a handle on this thing.
Marshall Hall, Chief Executive of Jamaica Producers Group. As we listen to the comments about globalization, I think the things that come to me immediately, first of all, is governance. And all of us in Jamaica know the IMF, we know the World Bank, we now know the WTO, we now know the ILO. So first of all, we have these large multilateral institutions that are now impacting on our day-to-day lives. Secondly, there's a variety of goods. As we walk into a supermarket, a store, beside the products of our local producers are the products of the international producers. And we have to compete fully at that level, at the local level. You can then imagine, as we strive to go overseas, we have to compete in their markets with their products. And that means quality, that means taste, that means variety. A different level is the concern of the consumer. And so when the consumer in the UK says, I want a banana that is grown in an environmentally friendly fashion, they are then insisting on all modes of production. And all of these things then impact. And so the borders disappear, and the variety flows, and something akin to world governance, not there yet, but something akin to world governance is beginning to appear.
I'm Ingrid Kaur, Chief Union Delegate of Victorian Turbulent Society. However, I'd like to come down a little lower in terms of what the baseman is going to think. And I think the first thing that he's going to think about is that when the market basically opens up, there's so much competition out there that the prices are now being challenged. And with the need for companies to reduce their prices to match those internationally, you have a lot of job losses. And that's what the man on the ground is going to feel, and that's where he's going to be looking at globalization from his point of view. He's also going to, the variety of products that we not only see in our supermarkets, but once we turn on the TV, everybody practically has cable now, and nothing that is on the TV is inaccessible in terms, everybody can get it. It's like an international market or supermarket. So it's everything is available, but then again, at the same time, people are losing jobs because of this opening up of the whole marketplace. And that basically is a problem, and it's an advantage. But that's basically what I think about when I think of globalization.
I'm Clive Dawson, president of the National Workers' Union. And my idea of what globalization is all about is that it basically have now put all of us in the world to operate under one set of rules. It was formulated by a few power brokers worldwide who saw the advantages for them. And my concern about globalization is that it has created a great deal of imbalance for developing countries like Jamaica. And while the concept may be one in terms of a direction in which the world should be going, I am very much concerned about the way in which it's being implemented, because we're starting out in a competitive kind of environment where the playing field is not level. And therefore, the consequences could have devastating effect on countries like Jamaica and our people.
You have heard the definitions. Now, what are the consequences? Let us hear how the discussion progresses.
My name is Dwight Nelson. I'm the Vice President of the Jamaica Confederation of Trade Unions. As companies strive to meet the intense competition brought about by goods coming in from foreign countries and external producers are able to produce these goods cheaper, more efficiently, and at a lower selling cost, Jamaican companies necessarily have to reconfigure their operations to produce greater efficiencies and to produce their goods at an improved quality and at a lower cost. And what we have seen is that this has resulted in a tremendous loss of jobs. So I think that the first consequence of globalization on Jamaica is a very negative one, the loss of jobs. I also think that one consequence which will flow from globalization is the opening of a window of opportunity for areas like retraining, development of new approaches and new attitudes at the workplace.
My name is Carl James, President of the Jamaica Exporters Association and Chairman of the Sugar Association of the Caribbean. We have, in addition to the loss of jobs, say in Jamaica, we have the window of opportunity to go into new areas of enterprise where Jamaica has the competitive edge over other people. It's a matter of then being selective. Where are the customers asking for what product? And then we organize our businesses to deliver those products at the competitive price, in the quality, and bearing in mind what was said earlier on, the environmental conditions under which they are produced. Globalization is a process, as was said earlier on, and if it does not bring benefit to all parties, it is not likely to continue along at the same pace it is going. But I believe that men are sensible enough to know that if it's something not in there for everybody, then those who don't have a stake in it will make sure it doesn't go any further. But it's a great opportunity for change and good change.
I agree with Carl about the opportunities that globalization presents for positive change, but these are opportunities which has to be recognized. For example, the loss of jobs and the retooling of the workplace, which is obviously essential, is not going to make us competitive unless at the same time attitudes and relationships at the workplace change, unless at the same time the old master-servant relationships give way to relationships of mutual respect in which there's fulsome communication between those who are leading and those who are following at the workplace. In fact, unless we develop a team approach to work and to production, then the loss of jobs and the retooling and the modernization won't have the benefits that it would otherwise have. Secondly, I think we need to focus on those areas where Jamaica obviously has a global advantage. There's not a country in the world today that one could go out of the 190 or any major city in which Jamaican music has not penetrated their particular marketplace. There's not a country we can go to in which the Jamaican brand name as a place for leisure and for tourism is not known. And I therefore feel that if we develop a concept of our country in that framework where we would focus on activities related to leisure, the entertainment industry, music, hospitality, that the jobs which are being lost, unnecessarily so, in banana and in sugar and in bauxite, would possibly be compensated for by the jobs that are being created in those areas of the economy where we have a big advantage over the rest of the world.
First of all, for us to create the new job opportunities, we need to have an investment climate in a country that is going to be attractive to companies who want to come here or Jamaicans who want to invest their money in further business activity. And price is one aspect of it. And price is not only the cost of labor. Price is the cost of security. And one has to have tremendous security in Jamaica because there are scallywags who are putting drugs in trailers that are carrying our goods outside of the country. We need to have a proper road system in the country because the cost of a truck that takes 4 hours to get to the airport versus the cost of a truck that takes 1 hour to the airport is a price factor. It is not singly labor. It is to make the entire marketplace conducive and sensitive to the issue of price, because we will have to bring down all of our costs if we're going to compete in a marketplace in which the world is competing with us.
And I have a real big question as to whether we have decided what we want, whether we have decided that we are going to really unequivocally seek to attract foreign investment, whether we really want to have tourists here, for example, whether we really want to have those industries that probably negate somewhat of our national identity but bring us in more resources. I don't think we have really made up our mind as a country, you know.
One has to make choices about what you want to do. And in 1995, in Grace Kennedy, we made some choices, some very hard choices. We were involved in many different businesses, and we recognized with globalization, we had to choose a few and become world-class at those and extend that benefit not only throughout Jamaica, but throughout the rest of the world. The flip side of that, however, is we had to make a harsh choice to exit certain businesses, that there are certain products we would no longer manufacture, certain businesses we would no longer be involved in, and we did so. And what we have done is to use the resources freed up by that to concentrate on the other things that remain. But the net effect has been that the company has grown and that the staff who work with us have also benefited from this process. As a result, we have invested very heavily in machinery, equipment, but most importantly, I believe the key thing is in the quality of the staff who work with us. And also in parallel to that, the relationship between us, that we see ourselves now as a team. It's not managers and workers any longer. It's all of us in this thing together on this rock called Jamaica. We're all the same people, from the messenger to the chairman. We all have the same objective. So how do you move that forward? I believe that we need to start at the workplace, at the individual level, because we have a society where we tend to deal with things in generalizations. And I think to move ahead, we have to start one-on-one with each other.
The question now comes back to, if we want to come on top of this globalization thing, how can we as a group and not separate individuals, you know, because I have money, I have the right to say this or whatever, and you have no say in this.
And because I'm a worker, I'm going to destroy your business by not working. There can be a common ground. And as far as I'm concerned, we need to first look at how do we see ourselves as an employer, an employee? How do you plan to work with your employer or your employee to get where you're going? And it has to be a mutual agreement, and you have to see each other as human beings and treat each other accordingly to move forward.
My concern is about how it's being implemented. And I want to just look briefly at some of the negatives that are flowing from it. First of all, regardless of how competent the business may be in Jamaica, you're starting off at a disadvantage because of the difference in our economy, say, to a country that has already been developed economy. And therefore, you're competing not only against a sharper workforce, a company where you have capabilities in terms of technology and the like, but also where what they're producing are being subsidized by their own government to a great extent, which give them another competitive edge over you in terms of pricing and so on. And therefore, I think that in all of this, we need to begin to look at how can we continue this process to ensure that as partners in the process and as a developing country, we can see where there are some light at the end of the tunnel, because we are operating basically within a group of what I would call regulations that take into consideration the fact that we are not yet at the level of countries, a number of countries in the world, and therefore we need to be treated in a particular way. I recognize that we have to move away from the protectionism situation, that we have to become competent and be able to be competitive in the world, but it cannot be done overnight. And what, in my opinion, globalization is doing to us right now is wanting us to become instant sort of competitors of countries like North America and so on.
So those are the consequences of globalization. But what are we going to do? What are the strategies which must be used to tackle this very enormous challenge, one which we cannot ignore?
At a review of the process in the bauxite alumina sector, where a memorandum of understanding was arrived at between the government, the companies, and the trade unions and the workers. And what that review showed is that the productivity levels are indeed increasing significantly, not only because there is a certain amount of retooling and re-equipment taking place, but very, very importantly, because the relationships at the workplace are being reorganized, moving away from the old-time master-servant, moving into a situation where people operate as teams, where any bauxite alumina worker can tell you where his plant ranks in the global marketplace in terms of cost efficiencies, and where information is shared. This is really, really very important, because unless we change the internal relationships at the workplace to mutual respect, full information sharing, team building and communication, we'll not be able to fulfill the potential that we have. And I think that we are showing that it is possible, not just in bauxite alumina, in a number of the sugar factories at Appleton, for example, a great team building process is on the way. And it shows that we can do it, and when we do it, the productivity levels become more and more internationally competitive.
The international competitiveness is something that we need to stress, because at the very first level, the results of a lack of competitiveness by a Jamaican company is a failure of that company, a closure of that company. And several companies, in an attempt to remain open, to stay competitive, to be able to continue to sell their products, have got to seek the mechanisms for modernization. And this competition comes in the old time days. It was, you know, Grace and Mekala in competition with one another. Today we have seen the influx of the Trinidadians coming into our own marketplace now and buying assets in our marketplace. They're going to become a major player in the insurance field in Jamaica. They've acquired the cement company, and they're going to become a major player in the cement production in Jamaica. We have international competition coming in from everywhere, and we have got to recognize that first the companies themselves have to recognize the problems that they have, and where those problems reflect on improved productivity, that improvement has to be put in place.
I just want to reinforce the need to pay meaningful attention to the whole question of productivity, because or increased and improved productivity, because I think that this is one of the primary areas or avenues through which we are going to have to work ourselves up the ladder in the face of the kind of intense international competition that globalization produces on Jamaica. Because I think we have to move away from the myth that productivity or improved productivity necessarily means increased input from labor. I think that to improve productivity, it is going to take inputs from all parties, from management, from worker, and indeed from the state, from government. I want to state on behalf of the Confederation of Trade Unions that productivity is something that the trade union movement accepts that there is a need to address. It is something that the trade union movement accepts that there is a need to improve, and it is something that the trade union movement certainly is prepared to face with the necessary profundity. I think that there's also another area that one need to look at. One of the major solutions, of course, must be training and retraining of employees. And when I speak of employees, I take Doug Urain's broad definition that employees include everybody from the office maid up to the CEO. And training is very important. Training becomes the prerogative not only of the companies. You know, there are a number of companies, Grace, Mekala, that spends a lot of resources on training of employees. I think that many other Jamaican companies need to follow their examples and channel resources into training of workers. Well, I think that training is also becomes also a very, very important prerogative of the trade unions. You know, I think that trade unions must now look at training not only from the point of view of the hardcore trade union training that, you know, that they have addressed historically, but training now to encompass new attitudes, new approaches, understanding how management work, and improving the relationship between management and workers.
It brings up the question, training for what? Because now as we go through this turbulent period, we are pointing the finger at training. And the question of training for what is very important. To my mind, training means taking responsibility. Training will be useless in the long term if it doesn't mean that the workers take responsibility for their own development, for their own growth, because we need to have a more informed workforce that is understanding of the things that they need, the skills they need to have, and the things that they need to do. The concept of lifelong learning, for example, is important, and this is why organizations like the Workforce Development Consortium have as their focus providing labor market services and providing the type of information that people need to train for flexibility, to train for multi-skilling. And the problem that we face is the low literacy levels, because unless people are prepared to bring themselves to at least a grade 9 standard in literacy and numeracy, the new skills training being offered and a new skills training that is necessary will not benefit them and will create a worker underclass.
I think that Jamaica, being a tropical country, needs to take advantage of the information available under globalization, where they have indicated one of the fastest growing areas of business is in the whole business of supplying tropical fruits and foods. We boast some of the finest quality tropical products, except we are also known for only supplying small samples of it. And one of the things we're going to have to do as we re-examine where we are, what the customer wants out there, and what we can produce, is to look at these orchards that I listened to the Minister of Agriculture listing that they're going to establish. Whether it is naysberry, it's avocado, it's ackee, it's guava. We used to produce one of the finest guava jelly, but we import most of the ingredients now. And I think that
the business of really going into serious agriculture is not going to be subsistence farming now. It is going to be investment in farming. And then from the basic agricultural raw material, we go the route of the value added, which is going to demand acquiring appropriate technology and then learning from the Grace experience to brand your product properly and put it in the marketplace.
What are we being trained for? I had a meeting with some of my workers, and I kept trying to put across them, you need to be multi-skilled. I knew some of them were going to be made redundant, so I kept pumping it into their heads. I couldn't tell them that they were going to be made redundant, but I kept pumping it into their heads. You need to invest some of that money you get from your redundancy package into training. And somebody said to me, train for what? What new eras are there going to be?
I am satisfied that Jamaica can last the distance. What does it take? It takes, first of all, training, yes. It also takes process reengineering. What do I mean by that? I mean by we have to go back and look at every single process in banana. Productivity is more about working smarter than working harder. And working smarter means understanding what you do, means finding a way to improve it 1%, 2% here, every corner. I am satisfied that the training that we must talk about, therefore, is helping the worker, A, to understand the process, helping the manager to understand the process, helping all of us to be fully conversant with the specifics and details of the job. When we talk about teamwork, teamwork is vital. What is teamwork? Teamwork at one level is identifying the team. At another level, it is getting every single employee to feel that they are part of the larger structure. Final comment, information. Information flow through the organization is a function not only of getting the information right, but getting it quickly. That is what the change is about, because armed with that quick information, you can then fast response time to any problems that exist.
I think that a very important factor in here is how we go about creating the new investment to create the new jobs. And I think that is defined into, I think, basically two types of groups. I think you need to look at big investment. I think you need to look at large international companies, large Jamaican companies expanding within the marketplace, particularly the Jamaican companies who have the knowledge of the marketplace and can bring assistance to the international investors to come in here. But I think also at the both big and small level, you have the opportunities that are currently not being taken in Jamaica. I think, for instance, tourism, and somebody earlier mentioned it, is sun and beach. But tourism is a far more sophisticated product internationally in the world today. We don't have much of that sophistication. We need to look significantly at attractions in Jamaica. We need to provide entertainment for tourists who come to Jamaica other than the sun and the beach. That's a niche market. I think Jamaica has a competitive advantage. Studies have shown that we have a competitive advantage in informatics. And informatics is not only simply answering telephones when you call American Airlines or Air Jamaica to find out what time your flight is, but it goes more sophisticated than that in terms of marketing, in terms of development of computer programs, etc. I think this is an area that we need to look at. We need to focus and target specific areas in which we can train people. And I think, finally, I think that the small business opportunities must be explored, where we can find groups of people that have natural talent and take those natural talents and turn it into some sort of profitable business venture. But whatever we do, the creation of new jobs can only come about by providing the climate for further and increased investment.
The government and the other partners have a really important role to play in some concrete ways. Firstly, on the issue of productivity and giving people the incentive to raise their levels of output. One of the things that has made such a vast difference in the bauxite alumina sector is that earnings which workers make
from certified productivity incentive schemes are tax-free. If the government were to find itself able to do that in relation to other sectors of the economy, believe you me, you would find the productivity curve going through the sky, because people would then feel it is worth their while to work harder, to work smarter, because it's going to impact on their pockets. Secondly, in relation to getting in that new investment, which is so important to creating additional jobs, of which Joe Matalon spoke, the government again has a very important role in the provision of proper transport, most of all in ensuring that there's a security, a law and order environment. But in addition to that, in being willing and able to modify the tax environment, the fiscal environment, to make investment attractive. In relation to the unions, we need to also look at providing new services in this new environment. The formal economy is contracting, the informal economy is expanding. The unions are perhaps the most experienced organization, not just in Jamaica, but in the world, in terms of negotiation, in terms of conflict resolution strategies. We need to be providing services to people in the informal sector, to community organizations, when they may need to negotiate something. The vision for Jamaica, which would pull all of this together, is we are a brand name throughout the world, almost a brand name without the products. And in the hospitality industry, if we were to focus on that, if we were to pick winners, it would have significant implications for the development of manufacturing, for the expansion of agriculture, and so many other linkage industries which would be able to provide more jobs and meet the needs of this globalized environment.
The brass knuckle of it all is that workers have to realize that they have to all grow up. There's a responsibility we all have to ourselves, not just as workers, but as human beings, to ensure that we survive. And one of our survival tactics is that we're going to have to realize, we're going to have to retool ourselves in terms of training. We're going to have to go out there and realize that our managers, our bosses are not the persons who are going to make or break us, but we have to go and take a step and say, okay, I have to make a decided path and go this way or that. I have to see where I'm going, what am I interested in, what happens if they get rid of me, what is it that I can really do, and what can I do for the betterment of my country. So we're going to have to go there and retool in terms of our educational, what is it that you are good at, are you best at sewing, can you go there and farm, what is it that is out there that is demanding that you can go and join and do. Don't just depend on, okay, well, my work can do this or my work can do that. We have to think of what we can do as personnel. That responsibility rests on us as individuals.
There are many more strategies which we have to explore. Personal responsibility, global vision, so much to do. But we haven't got the time to go into all of them. I would excite your own imagination to discuss even further additional strategies. Let us close now by looking at the vision which each panelist here brings to this question of globalization. What does it mean to me?
Marshall Hall, Jamaica Producers Group. In thinking about the vision for the future, I'd first of all start with the government. My vision is an alert government. Alert in the sense that it understands what is happening in the global marketplace, that we participate fully in things like the WTO, like the ILO, like the IMF, make sure that our voice is heard, our problems are understood. An efficient government, no waste, a corruption-free government. As far as my company is concerned, or the company I work for, I envision a company that is on the cutting edge of agriculture, on the cutting edge of demonstrating that our products can be quality and quantity and be there every place in the world. As far as a people, as far as my children, my grandchildren are concerned, it is vital, and this is at one level so simple, but it is vital that all of us really know how to read and write. Because with that literacy capacity will go creativity. And by that I mean, as we think about the workplace, the business about being willing to change, the business about understanding that you can no longer expect to start in company A and end up retiring from Company A means an educational process that allows the individual to be creative, to change, to be flexible. That is what my vision is all about.
I'm Joan Lawrence, Agricultural Credit Bank, delegate for the National Workers Union. My vision is firstly for a multi-skilled worker who will be able to fit into different areas of the workforce. Number two, a different kind of management who will have a better relationship with workers. And three, an improvement in governance, which will encourage all of us, the worker, the management, everybody, to improve ourselves.
I'm Carl James, President of the Jamaica Exporters Association. My vision as a result of globalization for Jamaica is that we have aware business people, informed business leaders, responsive managers to the customer demands, a willingness to reorganize, restructure, to apply the appropriate technology, and to become as efficient as one can in producing the goods and services required at a price that will be accepted by the customer and a consistency that is going to establish that entity in the marketplace. It's global, it's borderless, but it has some standards that provides opportunities for Jamaican business, and we must seize every moment and every opportunity.
Blossom Amelie Nelson, Project Director of the Workforce Development Consortium. I think it's imperative for us as we move forward to understand that there is no one solution and that we will have to continuously review our common goals. We'll have to understand our common goals and have a commitment to our common goals, and that goes across public and the private sector. And we will have to recognize that we have to take individual responsibility, workers and management, for making this thing work and for positioning us and placing us on the cutting edge that we need to be. And we also have to develop a tolerance for change. We keep on trying to find this level place where things will stop shifting on us, and then we can stay there as long as we like to make up our minds what we're going to do. That will never happen. We have to learn to run with it, even as it is happening, and to become tolerant of that change. And I think we also have to recognize, and my vision of a future that works is one that says we hold government accountable and we insist by participation that government works and government delivers.
My name is Dwight Nelson from the Jamaica Confederation of Trade Union. The problems of globalization is not a government problem. It is not a management problem. It is not a worker problem. It is a problem for all Jamaicans. It is a problem that all sectors of the Jamaican society have to combine, to face, to fight, and to overcome. My vision is that somewhere in the very near future, globalization will have proven itself to be the catalyst to have brought all these sectors together to fight a common problem, a common enemy, and secure a common victory.
I'm Trevor Munro. I'm president of the University and Allied Workers Union and professor at the University of the West Indies. For me personally, globalization, despite three university degrees, must mean more attention to my continuing education, to my personal development of mastery of the most modern technologies. Because if you're not doing that, then you're going to be left behind no matter how educated you are. Secondly, globalization means that I need to find and to make a bigger contribution in seeking for new ways of bridging gaps and bringing together people, whether it's student and lecturer, worker and manager, Jamaican at home and Jamaican abroad. We have to find a way of bridging the gaps, of coming together, because we are in one boat with many threats, but great opportunities. As a trade unionist, globalization means that we must become business partners,
with the managers and the owners in the enterprises where we represent workers, and it means we must offer services to those who, up until now in the communities and elsewhere, we have not regarded as part of our particular responsibility. For the government, globalization means, and I think Clive Dobson was right on this, that the way in which it is being implemented has to be changed. The free-for-all globalization has got to give way to a more regulated globalization, which would make the playing field a little more level than it is now for countries like our own. And finally, for Jamaica, I see Jamaica in the 21st century as the center of an immense global hospitality industry in which great implications for the development of our entertainment, of our sports, of our manufacturing, of our agriculture linked into this hospitality tourism, which is where we have our big competitive advantage and the possibilities of attracting new investment, creating new jobs, and more opportunities for us to really be a leading role in the next century.
My name is Ingrid Kaur, Chief Delegate of Victor Mutual Billing Society. My vision, finally, is that all persons have to realize, whether you're management or you're what you call a ground floor staff, that all are workers for the betterment of a company. And hence, I would like to see a vision where everyone respects each person's opinion, in that the worker, who normally has a hands-on feeling of what's going on, will be allowed to give his opinion on how something can work better. Because very often these persons are the ones who can say, well, we can make production a little better if you only did X or you did Y. And that respect, there have to be a respect of these persons' opinions by the management themselves, and accreditation given for all of this, so people feel that they're important. And if you have all of this, you'll be surprised how production can soar, because there's mutual respect on all parts. Also, I'd like to see that not only workers be trained, but management be trained in the whole issue of how you deal with workers, the different type of persons you have out there, so you can deal better with your staff, because that is also important in the workplace. And hopefully, with the 21st century that we're now approaching, we as a Jamaican population, who have shown the whole world that we have the ability to come above all else, will come above this millennium bug that is really the globalization as such, and step out and continue to be a strong force out there in the marketplace.
I'm Douglas Orane, Chairman of Grace Kennedy. First of all, my vision for our company, Grace Kennedy, is one which is continually increasing value for our customers. And to do that, it would mean that we need employees who are learning continuously about what is happening around them to pass on that value to others. So that makes it very clear the type of employee we need for the future. And that includes every level within the organization. I believe that we, as leaders, need to set an example and master the new technologies, master the new way of living in a globalized world, so we can pass that on through mentorship to others in the organization. I'm very optimistic about the future, because I do believe that the younger generation are willing and eager to participate, and what we need to do is to make the company as well as our society more inclusive to that energy and that enthusiasm. However, to run a world-class company, you have to run it in a world-class country. It is not possible to run a world-class company if you're not surrounded by a world-class country. And therefore, I see a future, and it is one that is driven by a certain urgency. I see a future where we need a tripartite arrangement, a consensus between employees, employers, and the government in order to define that vision for ourselves and move quickly to it. Why is it so urgent? The reason is simple. The rate of change is accelerating every single day. And while we debate these issues, other countries are moving even further ahead of us, including those that are our neighbors in this region. And so that is why I'm particularly heartened at the words spoken today by the employees who were part of our discussion. Because to me, it shows that Jamaica has changed. Jamaica is changing. those comments made today, I don't believe would have been made 5 or 10 years ago. And they have displayed a maturity which impresses me, an innovation which I find refreshing. And therefore, that's why I'm so optimistic about the future. I hope you are too. Thank you.
You have heard this discussion on this tremendous subject, globalization, and asked the question, what does it mean to me? Worker, manager, member of the community. What we have done here today is but a small portion of a large and complex subject which all of us will have to face sooner or later. So we invite you in viewing this to go away, as it were, and to think in your own mind on this very important theme. Globalization, what does it mean to me?